Good afternoon, students. Welcome back to economics class. In previous class, we have discussed about the syllabus that we are going to study in your second year BCom for macroeconomics. Now today we will be starting with your chapter number 1, that is money. We all are using money in our day-to-day life, but we hardly thought of that what exactly money is, how it came and why it came. So in this chapter we are going to study about the basics of money, that what is the need of money and why money came into existence. Now first we have to study about the definition of money. Now money is one of the greatest invention of the man. Man has invented so many things, like man invented fire, wheel. Similarly, money was also one of the invention that revolutionized the entire world. So money is something which changed the world drastically, and it is considered as one of the greatest invention of the man. Now money is defined differently by different people, so they are having a different views regarding the money. So today we are going to study about the various views or definitions of money. First, money has been defined differently by different economists, as there is no unanimity over its definition. That means there is no common agreement. So there is no uniform definition of money. Some economists are too extensive while others are too narrow. That means some economists, while defining money, they are using a wider spectrum, or they use wide view, whereas some definitions are narrow, which are only considering limited things into money. For example, Walker's definition of money is too wide or very broad. In the words of Walker, money is what money does. It seems to be a simple statement, but when you try to understand it, it is a very broad definition, because anything what money is performing, that is performed by if any other thing, it will be considered as money. So as per this definition, we can include all those things in money which perform the functions of money. That means money is not having only limited things in its definition. So that is why it is considered as a very broad definition, because it includes everything which is performing the functions of money. Now on the other hand, Robertson definition of money is very narrow, or which is very that specific, which considers only certain or limited things into money. Now what does he says? He says that money is a commodity which is used to denote anything which is widely accepted in a payment for goods or in discharge of other business obligations. That means he said that any commodity which is used for making payment of goods or making payment of your business debts or obligations, that will be considered as money. Now, according to this definition, metallic money alone deserves to be called money in the strict sense. That is why he has used the word commodity. That means only those things which are tangible will be considered as a money. So he considered metallic money alone as a money in a very strict sense. Now, there are other definitions also of money which is more popular. Now some economists define money in legal terms, saying anything which state declares as money is money. Now here the word state means government or the financial authority. So anything which is backed or supported by the government will be considered as money. So that is why it is in a legal terms. So the money which we are using today, paper currency, that is also known as a legal tender money, because it is legally enforced or legally backed by the government. So thus money possess legal sanction to discharge debts and perform other functions of money. Legally it is binding, like today's currency. If this currency is not fake currency, then nobody can refuse to accept that currency because it is legally enforced or imposed by the financial authority or government of a country. But legal sanction alone is not a significant factor. That is, legal sanction is not the most important factor in making money as general acceptable. Certain things are generally acceptable. They are not legal, but still they are generally acceptable. So the criteria for considering anything as a money must be general acceptability and not alone legal sanction. For example, the bank deposits or credit money are not legal tender money, but these are generally acceptable in payment and are actually constitute a major part of the circulating medium. Today, we all know that there are various money instruments which we are using, that is credit instruments. So, for example, if you want to make a payment to anybody, you can issue check, but check is not a legal tender. That means it is not legally binding on the acceptor. If, for example, if you are buying anything from me and you are making payment through check, then I can refuse to accept check, or I can say that I don't accept check, you have to make payment in terms of cash. So I can refuse it. It is not legal binding. Whereas the currency note which is issued by a government is a legal binding. So there are two things. One, a legal tender money which is legally enforced by a government. Another is your that general acceptability. So check, demand draft and other modes of payment, like nowadays we are using Paytm, Google Pay, all these payment modes are not legally enforced, but people are accepting it as a medium of exchange. Now further, there are certain definitions of money. A suitable definition of money should be emphasizing not only on the important functions of money, but also on its basic character known as general acceptability. So the definition will be considered as more suitable, which is emphasizing on the general acceptability principle of any commodity. That will be considered as a money. For example, from this point of view, Crowther's definition appears to be ideal definition, or the most popular definition we can say, or most acceptable definition of money is considered Crowther's definition, because it is fulfilling the criteria of ideal definition. So what he says, money is anything that is generally acceptable as a means of exchange and at the same time act as a measure and store of value. Now he has used a certain technical things in his definition. First thing is, he is emphasizing on the acceptability as a means of exchange. That means the commodity which is considered as a money must be acceptable as a medium of exchange. Means of exchange means medium of exchange. And at the same time, simultaneously, it must act as a measure and store of value. These two terms we'll be discussing in later slides, where we will be discussing about the functions of money. So he has given the three important terms in his definition, that is medium of exchange, measure of value and store of value. Now, as money definition is based on its function, therefore the definition of money is also known as a functional definition. So the most general way to define money is to lay down its main function, the various functions of money can be classified into four groups. Money performs many functions. These functions can be grouped or these functions can be clubbed in four categories. First is your main function. This is also known as a basic function or primary function. Second one is secondary function. Third one is contingent function. Fourth one is your other functions, or we can say miscellaneous functions. Now we'll discuss all these functions in detail. Main functions, these functions are also known as original or primary functions of money, sometimes basic functions of money, because these are the functions for which money was developed. In the beginning I told that money is one of the greatest invention of the man, and we all know necessity is the mother of invention. So now we have to identify that what is the need, or what are the factors that resulted into the development or evolution of money. So first, money is a medium of exchange. That is its first function. Second is, money is a measure of value. Now these two are considered as the primary function or original or basic function of money. Now we'll discuss these two functions in detail. Money as a medium of exchange. Now we have to imagine that before money came into existence, how business was done, or how people were trading with each other, or how the things were exchanged with each other. So money, before money came into existence, the system which was prevailing in every economy is known as a barter system. In barter system, goods and services are exchanged in exchange of goods and services. That means goods for goods or services for services. That system is known as a barter system. Now, that system was prevailing for a very long period of time, but gradually people realized that there are certain difficulties, or there are certain drawbacks of this particular system. That is why they were finding out something that can overcome that drawback and will be considered as a medium of exchange. So they developed money. Now what we have to consider while discussing the money as a medium of exchange? First thing is, this may be considered as the most basic function of money. Money has the quality of general acceptability. As such, all exchanges take place in terms of money. Today, we are exchanging everything with the help of money, whether it is goods, whether it is services or anything, we exchange it with the help of money. In ancient time, as I told, commodities used to be exchanged for the commodities. That system is known as a barter system. But this system was having certain drawbacks. Due to the difficulties of barter system, money came into existence. What kind of difficulties we were facing? First, there is a requirement of double coincidence of want. Double coincidence of want means that we have to find a person who needs the commodity which I want to sell. At the same time, I have to find the person who is having the commodity which I want to purchase. So that is double coincidence. Double coincidence in the sense, I have to find a person who is having the commodity which I want. At the same time, he must be willing to exchange that commodity with the commodity which I am having. So that is known as a double coincidence of want. Another difficulty was the division of commodities. Like in case of cattle or in case of animals, there is a problem of subdividing. If somebody don't want to buy the commodity in a huge quantity, then it is very difficult to subdivide that. For example, a cow is having a value equal to 4 goats. Now I have to find a person who is having a goat and who want a cow in exchange of that. even if I'll find the person, then I need four goats in exchange of one cow. But if a person is not having a four goats, if he is having a three goats or two goats, then I cannot divide my cow in accordance to the availability of the goat to the other person. That is, you cannot subdivide or you cannot break the cattle into small pieces so that they can be traded. So these are some of the difficulties. That is why money came into existence as a medium of exchange. Second important function of money is money as a measure of value. Earlier what happened, that every commodity need to be expressed its value in terms of another commodity. For example, if I am having a wheat, then I have to that identify the value of wheat in every other commodity which is circulating in the economy. For example, if there is pulses, groundnut or maize which is circulating in an economy, then I have to express my commodity, that is wheat's value, in terms of pulse, groundnut or maize. So I have to express my value, commodity's value, in each and every commodity which is circulating in an economy. So there is lot of kiosk which is going on, or it is very difficult to remember the value of each commodity in terms of another commodity. Therefore, money is considered as a common rod of measure. That means every commodity's value will be converted into money terms, and with the help of money only we have to make the comparison between values of two commodities. So the second important function of money is that it measures the value of goods and services that we are going to trade. Another thing is, in other words, the prices of all goods and services are expressed in terms of money. Every commodity's value is expressed in terms of money. So money is the common thing which is binding all the goods and services which are available in a economy. Since all the values are expressed in terms of money, it is easy to determine the rate of exchange between various types of goods and services in the commodity. As I told that if I am having one commodity and there are four other commodities which are circulating in economy, so I have to remember the rate of exchange of my commodity in terms of all other four commodities. Whereas if all the four commodities price is expressed in terms of money, then I have to just remember the exchange rate of money, not of individual commodity. Secondary functions are also known as a derived function. These functions are dependent on the primary function, or they are derived out of the primary function, or we can say it is a sub part of your primary function. That is why it is known as a secondary function. So these are considered as a secondary function because they are derived from the original or primary functions of money. Following are the two main functions of a money, which is considered as a secondary function. First one, money as a standard of deferred payment. Second, money is a store of value. Now we'll discuss these two in detail. Third one is a transfer of value, which is again sub part of your primary function. Money as a standard of deferred payment. Deferred payment means delay payment, future payment, credit system. I am buying commodity today, I will make payment in future. At the time of barter system, it was very difficult to make future payment or delay payment. But in terms of money, we can make the future payment. So in the absence of money, borrowing and lending were very difficult. Borrowed and lending amount could be returned only in terms of goods and services. That means if I am a farmer, I have given a wheat to somebody else, then somebody else has to give me another commodity only, or he has to return the wheat to me. So what commodity I have lent it to him, he has to return the same commodity to me. So it was very difficult to maintain the quality and standard of a particular commodity. That is why the lending and borrowing were difficult at the time of barter system, and this difficulty was removed due to the money. But in modern times, we are greatly dependent, or we are having a facility of borrowing and lending process in terms of money. We all are using the credit system today. I will be purchasing the commodity and will be making payment in near future. So that is possible only due to money. This is because money is more durable as compared to other commodities. That means the quality of money is not deteriorating or reducing due to passage of time. As the time goes, the value of the money is not reducing as compared to other commodity. See, if I am having a commodity and I am storing it, then its quality or its value is going to change in future. It is going to reduce. Like the we can take an example of any commodity, like the any furniture that you have purchased today. If you want to sell it after few months, you will be getting less price of that furniture or that asset because its value has reduced. So that is why money came into existence as a means of deferred payment. Then money is a store of value. Money acts as a store of value. That means the value of anything can be stored in terms of money. So any commodity can be converted into money and its value can be stored. Money is generally acceptable and its value is more or less stable. Being non-perishable and also comparatively stable in value, the value of other assets can be stored in the form of money. Every other asset can be converted into money. As a store of value, people's preference of money over other assets is flowing essentially from characteristics of liquidity of money. Money is the most liquid asset. Anything can be converted into money, or money can be converted into any other thing. Third important function is transfer of value, which means we can transfer the money from one place to another place. Or transfer of value is also known as a transfer of purchasing power. That means when money moves from one person to another person, it is transferring the purchasing power of that amount from one person to another person. By transferring money from one person to another, the value can be transferred. Then the value of any asset can be transferred from one person to another person or another institution by transferring money from one place to another. Like today, if I want to make payment at any other place outside my home place, I can transfer it with the help of money. The transfer of money can take place irrespective of places, time and circumstances. That means money transfer can take place in any circumstances, or there is no geographical restriction, or there is no boundation. That is why money acts as a transfer of value. I hope these two functions, that is primary and secondary functions, are clear to you. In next class, we are going to study about the other functions of the money. Thank you very much.